So now the hard part starts. All this is just easy. The hard part is this. So what I described to you in words and five equations I showed you, those are part of the total number of equations, which is close to 50. And we have close to 50 parameters. A lot of these parameters we know by the order of magnitude. But that's useless for such big system of equations because, you know, if you know the parameter which is between 2 and 4, let's say, it's fine for one equation. But when you have 50 parameters, each of them between 1 and 10, you have orders and orders of magnitude in the end, and the errors could be tremendous. So here's what we do. We run the so-called genetic algorithm. It's not pioneered by us. There are a number of papers already done with it, though they so far dealt with simpler problems. Here's the idea, and that's why we need so much experimental data. Computer first chooses about 10,000 models randomly. What it means is equations are always the same, but it randomly chooses 10,000 sets of 50 parameters. Each parameter is within the range that we know. And then each of these models is simulated automatically by computer. Then computer compares theoretical and experimental results just using usual statistical arguments, that the greater the least square error, the worse. And then rejects most of the models which are bad. Takes the best models and start genetic algorithm. So then two best models meet, exchange some parameters, and shift some other parameters. So that's mutation and recombination. And then simulates those models. And then it goes on and on and on for 200 generations. At the end, we have models which are perfect, meaning that they explain all experimental data with almost no error. So it seems that at this point we could declare victory, but then we have the worst problem. The hint of it. So we ended up with about 10,000 perfect models. Here's the problem. Some of those models are very different, like this one and this one. So what's shown here is time series for forces from different four populations of microtubules. Some other models are very similar. So the question is, how do you can't look with the naked eye, you can't as a human look at 10,000 models and tell which are basically the same model, which are very different, what do you do next? So you have to cluster models somehow. So many of those models are different from each other just by one coefficient, which 10% different. But you can't do it anymore with your hands. So that's what we ended up with, this bewildering variety of perfect models. So what this shows is those are 11 switches that we have in the model. White shows the time when the motor is on, black the time when the motor is off. And every horizontal line here corresponds to single model. And so there's 10,000 models vertically, and those are predicted time series. Now, how do you just look at it and tell how many really different models you have? Well, it seems that, for example, like there's a lot of models here which are the same biologically. It doesn't matter that there's some fluctuation of parameters. So, and that similar thing. So then we had to do clustering algorithm, right? So we just use some clustering. So that's a big program, at least for me. So there's a lot of computer science that going into modeling like that. So there are some clustering algorithms that allow you to automatically, without thinking, figure out which of these models are the same, too close to each other, which are different. And that's not as simple as you think. So we thought originally that what would happen? Like imagine that you have three-dimensional parameter space and you have scatter of points corresponding to different models. So okay, you see that, like one constellation of points together, this is the same model. Another constellation, this is another model. But in fact, the problem is that they are scattered without any obvious pattern. So one model can correspond not really to a three-dimensional ball in three-dimensional space, but to some weird two-dimensional manifold, right, that you don't know which. So there's really fancy cluster algorithms that allow you to sort these things out. So after we did it, and that took almost 2 years, that was the hardest part of this project, we figured out that there are a very finite number of model groups shown here with different colors, which are different from each other, and so all those models are basically the same biological model, the same biological strategy. This is another model, this is another, and so on. And then we used some additional analysis. So what was a big disappointment for us, and that's why this paper is soon appearing in Molecular System Biology rather than in Nature, where we actually were very close, but still got rejected. So we definitely wouldn't accept it. If we ended up with one model, one conclusive model, the data is not enough. We can only say that we have 11 possibilities. Right? And then biologists say, well, when you figure out which one of these 11, come back to us. We can't. We only can say which that there are 10 possibilities. We have additional arguments saying that our favorite candidate is this one group of models, but we can't prove that this is what's happening in nature. And so let me just describe to you what is this model. It's also impossible to remember. It's kind of cartoon, which is predicted by a computer. Right? So here's this cartoon. In the beginning, in prophase, or rather, like beginning of prometaphase, tiny motors are pulling on this microtubules outward, but there are these weird motors, chromokinesins, or called kinesin 13, acting on chromosome arms, which are actually, so sorry, this is chromokinesins also pushing the poles apart, but there's this kinesin 13 depolymerizing motor, which it's a pencil sharpener, try to pull the pole inward. So there's balance between these inward forces and outward forces. And outward forces win, and the spindle is elongating. Then at the next stage, very important motor, kinesin 5, this bipolar motor comes in, cross-links the interpolar microtubules and start to slide them apart. So what you see here is those are all four forces from four microtubule population. This is the distance between the spindle poles, right? And this is the total force in the spindle. So then some motors are inhibited by the spindle. Some new motors comes in, and there's this event after event. Some new motors come in, some motors go out. This is beginning of anaphase, this is anaphase A. Then anaphase B starts when some motors get deleted, and then it is all changing. So the point here is what we're predicting now is when are each of these 11 motors switched on and off. And this is impossible to tell just thinking. You have to do this humongous automatic procedure on the computer. And what is important, you have to use the data, which is not measuring when the motors are on and off. It's impossible. You have to use unrelated data, and you get your parameters from...
Since you put this linear relationship, you soften all this transition.
Right, yeah. That's an excellent observation. Besides the fact that it's very hard to work with nonlinear equations, linear equations kind of make everything very smooth. So we are working now on seeing what possible programs we could have if there were nonlinear models. So that's sort of recapitulation of this final model, and so that's sort of the big prediction in the end of the paper. So there are very interesting other predictions that the model gives. Remember, I told you that the parameters we don't know are not only the times at which motors are switching on and off, but actually the motor strength and the motor velocities. For most of the motors, they're just not measured. So, for example, the model predicts that for two most important motors in the spindle, one is one type of kinesin called density and another type of kinesin called, there are those force velocity curves. So each line here is the force velocity curve predicted by one of these 10,000 perfect models. Now, note very interesting thing from a philosophical point of view. There's certain robustness here, right? So you don't, you achieve the goal with any of those curves. But this is sort of only robustness to certain degrees. So robustness means that you can really change the force that the motor is producing about twice. And everything works fine. But you cannot change it 10 times. The thing breaks down. Because, for example, in many current modern models of biochemical transduction network, people look for perfect robustness, meaning that some parameter doesn't matter at all. Okay, so in speed node, it won't work like that. It should be regulated to a degree. But now note that any model predicts intersection between those force velocity curves. What does this intersection mean? Those motors work against each other. One tries to move to minus end of microtubule, another tries to move to plus end. And so one is pulling microtubule in one direction, another is another direction. The fact that they intersect means that at some velocity there will be force balance. So the forces would balance and microtubule would slowly creep in certain directions. So it is important. The models predict that if it wasn't so, the speed node wouldn't work. It means that some motor would get out of control and totally overwhelm another motor. And we actually were able to test experimentally this prediction. One of the postdocs in John's lab purified enough of both motors to make a gliding assay in which lots of these motors were on a cover slip. Microtubule was put on top of this slide, and he was able to vary the fraction of those motors. And got this result basically when the fraction of one of the motors was changing, the velocity of the microtubule was changing, and actually the direction of movement was changing. So indirectly, if you write simple equation, you can recover the force velocity curve from this data. So the irony was that this model, this work was so much simpler than this project that this was published a year before this whole project was accepted. So another little prediction which I want to draw your attention on, we didn't even mention it in the paper, because when we submitted it to Nature, that was the biggest point of criticism for us. It's basically too philosophical for real science. So what we observed was a very interesting observation. So if you go back to here, remember I told you this is the total force acting on the pole. And you see that this total force is in pica Newton range. And this is the consequence of very simple physics. Remember how the poles move. You apply total force to the pole, and then the velocity is basically this force divided by effective viscous friction coefficient. Viscous friction is known, at least the order of magnitude of it, it's not on the slide, but basically the point is that with known viscous friction, if you apply pica Newton size force, you will move with the velocity of the order of 1 micron per second. And that's sort of the order of magnitude of all these velocities. So you cannot apply total force equal to 100 pica Newtons, because then the spindle would go ballistic. Or you cannot apply force 0.01 pica Newton, nothing would happen. So the total force is known. Now, this total force, as you saw, is a balance of tens of different forces. Now, how do you get a balance equal 1 pica Newton from inward force and outward force? Well, you can apply 2 pica Newtons outward and 1 pica Newton inward. Or you can apply 10,000 pica Newtons outward and 9,999 inward. Right? Those are two choices. And by hands, we don't know. We don't just pick these parameters. So all perfect models, always, all of them, without any exception, were telling that the inward and outward forces separately are in the order of tens and hundreds of pica Newtons. So why not pica Newtons? Why not 10,000 of beginnings? So what we think we're sort of predicting is a certain design principle of the spindle, that you balance large outward and large inward forces, you get small results. The problem is, we don't know what it means and why the spindle is designed like that. We can only speculate. In fact, if you think about it, it's really a stupid way to do things, right? For the following reason. Imagine that you balance 5 and 4 Python newtons. Well, it would balance to 1 Python newton. But when you try to balance 1,000 at 999, the cell cannot control the numbers of the motors. It probably will be 900 to 1,100 motors on one side and similar on the other side. So how do you get the proper balance? We don't know. The only hint we have is, I think José mentioned in one of his lectures, that all these motors, actually the motor domains, are close relatives to each other. So all of these motors basically are the same. There are tiny little differences in mostly neck regions connecting this motor domains to the body of the motor. So all of these motor forces have the same temperature dependence of the force, for example, that they're producing or velocity. This is not solid experimental fact, but there are more and more hints from experimental literature that this is the fact. So that's actually is one of really interesting problems that theoretical physicists can work on. So temperature dependence of velocities and forces of motor proteins is very hot area. So if you have the same temperature dependence, then it kind of makes sense to balance big inward and outward forces. So basically, it's kind of, if you have this balance, this and temperature fluctuates, you kind of fluctuate outward and inward the same way. So I'm not sure if this is a good argument, and we cannot make it less vague. But that's sort of interesting thing that physicists can think about. And that's basically it. That's where I wanted to stop. So what are the lessons, I think, from all my lectures? It's probably clear by the time. First, the complexity at the cell level is tremendous. But it's not scary enough to discourage you from working in this area. I think actually it's a perfect window of opportunity now to start working on that, because as you saw, there's lots of work for physicists to be done, which biologists can't even start doing because the mind is not working in a certain way. But one has to be careful to ask the right questions, to ask the questions which biologists want to find answers on. Because what is very easy is to start working on some fantasy, and it will be a very elegant model, but it could have very little to do with biology. Which again, see, like this work of Doncic et al. I showed you, it's kind of a fantasy, but it's a concept model which is extremely useful, which tells some really interesting concept, which makes biologists think. And I could go on and on the different uses of modeling. For example, I never showed you a single model, which is probably the most useful kind, which shows you that some qualitative scenario which biologists thought work doesn't work. There are some very interesting examples like that. And why is it extremely useful? Because that's probably the least questionable thing for biologists. Well, you just showed that something doesn't work. Some people are very pissed off, but overall, the whole field is very grateful, because then they could start working on something else. Okay, at this point, let me end if you have questions.
Alex, one more time. I think that basically one of the underlying features that you should get from these lectures is that when you have this class of models and you try to see how each one works, you can go with what I like to say that's a physics attitude towards the problem, to see if there is some underlying principle, some design rule that's governing the system, right? In a sense, basically, how the entire system actually, what's the guiding principle that the system works to do that? And the sort of robustness is expected because people tend to use the word design, but remember, biology is not design, it's selected. And that changes a lot of things, not like there's an engineer there. So that means you really have some underlying principle where things are being selected versus many different things that are under there, and it seems work at the end. So if you think about that, this sort of what he calls fantasy, it's not the fact I don't like this word. I see this is the idea of trying to see which are the possible scenarios, yeah, and out of these many scenarios, where is the biological system trying to select? So, do you have some questions? Looks like people were out. Okay, we have questions.
So, this is appearing in this journal called Molecular System Biology. This is one of this daughter nature, nature journals. Like a couple of months. You can actually, anybody who is interested can email me. I'll email the PDF file.
So I have a simple question. So when you did a clustering, so how?
Sorry, what?
When you did a clustering.
Cluster.
So at the end point, you have to decide what is similar and what is not. So right. You have a threshold of similarity.
Right.
That has to be a number, otherwise you will end up to be like different level of clusters, right?
Right?
So how do you decide whether which point and turn out to be 11 models?
So right, that's a good, great question. So we actually use the advice of some very experienced computer scientists, and it turns out there are so-called robust clustering algorithms which do it without any parameters. And here's the idea. So what? You just try different criteria of clustering. The criterion worked in our case. So remember, I told you this analogy is three-dimensional parameter space. You can look for basically constellation of points from three-dimensional balls and three-dimensional cube. Well, if this doesn't work, it didn't work in our case. The problem is that, of course, we have 50-dimensional cube. Then you look for some other structures. So in our case, what worked was the convex sets of points in three-dimensional space turned out to be it. So well, let me just show you on the blackboard how it works. So if it was two-dimensional parameter space, okay, you could, if you're lucky, you get a structure like that. Right? So then you don't need any parameters. Clearly, this is one model, this is another. The problem is, what if points all over the place? In our case, we were lucky to find out that the structure we had was like that. Okay. So it turned out that the model is the so-called convex set of points. This is one model, this is another model, this is the third model, this is the fourth model. If you do it by hand, you would easily mistake this intersection for a model, but it's not. And again, the clustering algorithm like that doesn't require any numbers. And what is interesting, there's actually deep physical meaning behind this structure. The point is, I can't explain it simply, but the point is that if you try to, again, balance large inward and large outward force to almost zero, you always get the convex set of points like that. So in the end, it's simple physics that gives a structure. But the problem is that you cannot figure it out without massive computer search.
Just out of curiosity, how does this cluster algorithm hold in the maintaining any package?
So which is a package in
front of us? How do this method of clustering is called?
Oh, what is it called? You know, I don't remember. If you email me, I can send you the references. It's freeware, it's on the internet.
Nice.
It's very hard to use, but it's out there free.
That's
to a couple of it took this student who's absolutely brilliant about a couple of months to figure it out.
You said that after you did this, you went back and you did a single molecule thing to determine there. Could you then use those parameters to try to discard some of the other possible solutions that you had previously said were acceptable solutions?
That's an excellent question, and that's what basically all the reviewers ask us. Well, now do so clearly, yeah. If we do more experiments, we can use every additional piece of information to discard some of these 11 models and have just one left. The problem is that this specific experiment chooses 6 out of 11, and we actually in the final paper we have is 6, so 5 we discard. And the problem again that experimental biology is hard, so we have a list of experiments at the end of the paper. If they are done, and if the results would be of a certain kind, then we can get to one. But probably it will take years.
My question is a bit more general. So since you are doing the theoretical work, but always trying to make connection to the experimental work. But as an experimentist, I know that there are good papers and there are also bad papers. And some, there are some papers that that almost feel that I'm probably the only one who know that it's a bad paper. Some like you know some really specific details that nobody else will understand because they haven't done this measurement by themselves and so on. So how do you choose which data set to include in your modeling? Do you just trust the people or do you actually you know, go into all the details of the experiments to really figure out what could go wrong?
This is a terrific question. This is one of the greatest problems in doing modern biophysics if you want to stay really in touch with biology. Very difficult. It's basically a judgment call. So in our case, in this work, why I like it so much, I did some other work I'm proud of, but in this paper, all data came from one lab. And this is our joint lab, so we have no knowledge of what we trust at all. But what is more important, it's done on the same cells, on the same set of conditions. And Scully, my collaborator, is very well known for being extremely tough and discriminating. But not normally, all the factors you mentioned have to come to mind. You have to. So my advice is, if you start do something, some biophysics which is close to modern biology, you have to stay narrow. It's sort of these days it's almost impossible to be a great biophysicist of the past. You can't work both on. So I work on mitotic spindle and Drosophila and on migration of keratinocyte cells, and I don't try to do anything else. Simply because it's almost impossible to keep track of anything else that goes on out there. So when you spend enough years in the narrow field, you know everybody, so you know who to trust, who not to trust. And also you become efficient and like you read the paper, you know which data can be trusted, which is just there for window dressing, all of these things. But that's one of the tremendous problems. Because here's another beautiful story. So my former postdoc, George Oster, his advisor was Aaron Kachalski, one of the founding fathers of modern theoretical biophysics. He actually ended up being elected president of Israel and then killed by terrorists at the Israeli airport. It was a terrific crazy story. But anyway, it's not irrelevant. What is relevant? He has this famous saying, if your model explains 100% of data, it's most probably the model is wrong, because 90% of the data is garbage. So you really have to know, and this is exaggeration. But for example, in cell migration...
What is an underestimate?
Well, so in cell migration and in mitosis, the literature that I really know, my estimate is about 2/3 is good and 1/3 is garbage. So you have to basically know the field.
I think it was more than being garbage. I think the question, there's a lot of qualitative data.
Right.
And there's very few quantitative data. So not a question of being good or garbage, it's a question about how you take it.
Exactly.
And Han knows what he's talking about. Like, we're seeing a lot of guys like to plot the data just above the shot noise. So you never see the shot noise, you believe this beautiful data. What comes plot? So do we have any more questions? If not, I think we thank everybody for being here. It has been a great week all the way, and thank you for coming. And a couple things, if you have finished your evaluation form, leave with them. For some reason you haven't finished, you don't do it, or send back, and I think Lisa sent by email also, right? But make sure you send evaluation back. It's very important for the schools to continue to have it. And the funding agencies really need this information in a way of getting some feedback. So starting at 5 o'clock, we have our final discussion, but a little more relaxing set on the end of landing. And so see you guys a little bit there. Question? No. We start at 5, but we let's try to start the discussion by 5:30, okay. 4 to 6, so we can have a little discussion as well. You don't have to be 5 sharp, but don't try to get like 7. It'll be too late for everyone. Okay?
For like 20 minutes. Yeah.
All right.
Right, that's not good.